Homosexuals have a very high incidence of sex addiction because they are trying to find love and identity in places where it can never be found. One day I was asking God why He wasn't setting me free from a certain besetting sin, and He replied, "Because you still love it." Many lesbians will tell you that they chose to be lesbian. Few male homosexuals would ever say such a thing. Those who believe they are being zapped straight by God with one prayer are often receiving such a deep and profound healing in one area that they have mistaken it as the whole enchilada. Let's talk about the healing and deliverance of a homosexual. Since homosexual confusion develops from emotional and/or physical trauma or neglect, healing and deliverance play a huge role in the transformation process. As they tell you their story, the Holy Spirit will begin to point out the issues that are ready to be worked on. God may heal them of an issue all at once, or He may begin a healing that will take some time and many more sessions with either you or others. Forgo the grandiose promises that are too often spouted by those who try to put their faith on display. Be led by the Holy Spirit and say what He tells you to say. If God is saying nothing, then humbly and prayerfully pray according to the need that they have presented. Here is a list of just some of the issues that may come up as they seek God to be healed. Affirmation disorder. People who suffer from a lack of affirmation need genuine affirmation over a long period of time, and not just affirming words, but affirming deeds, as well as the presence of people who genuinely value and love them and can show that love in a nonverbal, affective way. Practicing the presence of God is a key way that they receive the affirmation that they need. As they draw close to God and receive His affirmations supernaturally, significant healing takes place. Healing also comes through the general fellowship that they find in a healthy local church and other gatherings of believers. It also comes in the pursuit of Spirit-led goals that bear fruit and thereby communicate to them value and purpose. Another issue that many homosexuals will have is anger at people. Learning forgiveness and learning how to let God empower you to forgive what seems unforgivable is critical here. Arrested emotional development is another issue that may need healing in any given case. Restarting the emotional growth that got shut down in the preteen years by listening to the Holy Spirit as He unveils the hidden keys and the timing of this process. In my case, God specifically told me to ask Him to impart the developmental pieces that were missing from the broken relationship that I'd had with my father, and to believe that He was indeed supernaturally imparting those into my soul. There's also the correction of the belief system that's needed, which requires Spirit-led challenge and correction about God, about love, about self, unbelief, about salvation, about living in a victim mentality. All of these issues will need to be addressed in many cases. Family line curses may be another issue that will be dealt with in any given case. Prayer to break the curse according to the promise found in Ezekiel 18 can be very important. It tells us in Numbers and Exodus and various places in the Bible that God passes on the sins of the fathers to the third and fourth generation. But it tells us in Ezekiel 18 that God will break that curse if any child decides not to go along with it. So get them to make a decision by the child not to follow in the sins of the father, and praying to that effect causes God to break the curse according to the power won for us on the cross by Jesus Christ. Fear of intimacy is another issue that will need to be dealt with. The ground of all sexual addiction is a fear of intimacy, and almost all homosexuals are also sex addicts. You see, when you're afraid of intimacy, you're trying to create an illusion of intimacy with pornographic images so that you don't have to risk the rejection that is sometimes found in attempts at true intimacy. Homosexuals have a very high incidence of sex addiction because they are trying to find love and identity in places where it can never be found, and because they fear developing intimacy with the God who they suspect is very angry with them and who may ask them to stop what they're doing, or the God that they are angry at because he hasn't done for them all that they have demanded and in the timing that they have demanded it. Guarding of the heart and mind, according to Philippians 4, 7 to 8, is another important issue. Learning to guard what they look at, what they listen to, where they go, who they associate with, the spiritual disciplines that they practice, all these things are vitally important. Also, immature response patterns to pain and stress need to be healed. Asking and believing God to supernaturally impart a new capacity to deal with pain and stress in a godly fashion, and then exercising that new capacity over and over and over again, so a new pattern forms. Part of the answer involves asking for and believing for a supernatural impartation of what is missing. And the other part involves partnering with God to put those new capacities into practice day in and day out. Intellectual idolatry is another issue. It's often found in sexually broken people. They put their faith in their intellect and what it shows them, rather than in the God who does miracles for those who believe without having an explanation or without being shown the reasons for things. Another issue that people will need to face in the healing process is their love of sin. One day I was asking God why he wasn't setting me free from a certain besetting sin, and he replied, "Because you still love it." I didn't know I still loved it, but it was a great revelation to me because then I knew how to pray. You see, people need to come face to face with the fact that they actually love certain sins. That helps them to get serious about renouncing their love for the sin and asking God to give them a hatred for that sin and a love for holiness in that area. The Bible says in Romans 12:9, "Hate what is evil and cling to what is good." It won't take too much time for the person to realize that this has to be a work of God in them, a work that must be sought and desired with all their heart. When they intentionally seek God to give them a supernatural hatred of evil and love of good, he will. With that supernatural gift on them, their resistance to temptation becomes significantly easier and more natural. Another issue is the participation in Christ's sufferings and his divine nature. God always takes us to a place in our healing process where we have to participate in suffering, so that we can become more knit to him, more like him in his death, and therefore take on more of his divine nature in that area. Another issue is performance orientation. Everybody has this to some degree. It's a huge problem, and people who are sex addicts, people who are in the homosexual lifestyle, they generally have it in spades. They're trying to earn the approval of God. They're trying to earn the love of God, or they've given up trying, and they're just leading a profligate life as a result of it. So performance orientation is a very significant thing that must be dealt with. The next issue is the renewing of the mind, and this is talked about in Romans 12, verse 2, a renewing of the mind. You do that through Scripture. You do that through being in the presence of good Christian teachers and teaching and so forth and so on. You do that by what you get rid of in your life. You do that by no longer watching certain kinds of movies and television programs and reading certain kinds of books. Renewing of the mind, very, very important. Self-hatred is also a big issue in most homosexuals, as well as all sex addicts. There's some degree, maybe it's not hatred, but it's self-disdain, or it's a sense of being unlovable or defective in some way. And this, of course, is not true. It's a lie of the enemy. They need to discover it to be a lie, and then to receive the affirming words of Christ in their spirit in order to get rid of it. Self-obsession is also another big issue that you often find, the sin of narcissism. We've talked about that earlier. Being a slave to feelings is another major issue that will need to be addressed in the homosexual community. This needs to be addressed pretty much worldwide, actually, today, because most people live by their feelings rather than by objective truth and reality. We let our emotions tell us what to do. And so because a homosexual feels that they love someone, because it feels like love, they actually believe that they are loving someone by having sex with them. And that's not love at all. The Bible teaches that love is commitment, love is sacrifice. It may have accompanying emotions and feelings to it, or it may not. You may be very upset when you push someone out of the way of a truck and get hit by it yourself, but you're loving the person in that moment. So we have to deal with the issue of the slavery that people have to feelings. Feelings are good, but they should never be the thing that directs our choices of what's real and what's valuable. Transformation of the will is another huge area that needs to take place in all of us. And that happens through revelations of God's love during our intimate times with Him, when He reveals His glory to us. And by seeing His glory, the sins that we've been tempted to become ridiculous in comparison over time. So our will becomes transformed. We fall in love with Him, and we go from obeying Him because we're supposed to obeying Him because we want to. We've fallen so much in love with Him. There are other issues that also need to be dealt with in any given individual. There's often an anger at God Himself. Sometimes there are familiar spirits. Sometimes there's a need for true repentance. Some people have believed that they have repented before God when they actually haven't repented at all. Romans 2, verse 4, and 2 Corinthians 7, verse 10 talk about this. True repentance is, in fact, true interior grief and sorrow over having hurt the one that you love who died on the cross for you. It's not being sorry you got caught. It's not being sorry that you're messed up. It's not being sorry about a lot of things. It's being sorry that you have hurt the God who died for you and being grieved over that. And that's what elicits true repentance and a true desire not to do it again. Worship is another huge part of the healing process, at least it was in my life. When you worship God, you're actually engaged in spiritual warfare. Demons actually flee in the presence of ongoing worship, where you're praising the Lord of hosts. So worship is an important part of the healing process, and teaching people how to worship on a regular basis can be very important.
Pure passion that beats for Christ alone.
Let me tell you about a classic book written by our very own David Kyle Foster. It's called Sexual Healing, A Biblical Guide to Finding Freedom from Sexual Sin and Brokenness. In print for almost 15 years now, the newest version has been revised and updated to provide the very best teaching possible on how to get free from sexual sin and healed from sexual brokenness. God wants to heal and forgive sexual sin and brokenness. Sexual Healing was written for those who want and need freedom. It's a real-life testimonial to what really works in seeking God's deliverance from pornography and other sexual addictions, masturbation, sexual abuse, and even homosexual confusion. Filled with God's truths concerning holiness, Sexual Healing contains chapter exercises for practical guidance, making it useful for both group and private study. Sexual Healing gives well-founded hope to those who are willing to take brave steps toward a God and a Father who loves them. To obtain Sexual Healing by David Kyle Foster, go to purepassion.us. That's purepassion.us.
The younger a person begins the process of healing from homosexuality, the fewer the number of related issues that need to be addressed, the cleaner the person has been living in relation to sexual morality, the faster they will see healing. A teenager, for example, can expect for a large percentage of their healing to come in just a few years of dedicated, obedient searching and receiving from the Lord. An older gentleman, say in his 50s, who has been in the lifestyle for many decades, has lived a life filled with many deep perversions, who has self-identified as gay for decades, and who has many, many issues at the root of his orientation, may not see a full turnaround in his orientation before he dies. However, God will be just as pleased with him and his pursuit of that transformation, even though not fully realized in this life, as he will be with a teenager who was healed rather quickly, because God is not looking for performance and achievement, but for the heart who remains fully given over to him. In ministering to young people today, remember that our education system and culture has programmed their thinking. And so they will come to you believing many lies about you, about God, and about themselves. As a result, you will rarely see a quick turnaround on the prayer line of a complex issue like homosexuality. You can be, however, one piece in a much larger puzzle by which God will set them free. Although there are claims of instant and permanent healing by a few, and God can certainly do that if He wishes, my experience in almost 30 years of ministry has been that God prefers to take us through a healing process by which He uses the healing of a single issue to bring healing to many issues. Those who believe they are being zapped straight by God with one prayer are often receiving such a deep and profound healing in one area that they have mistaken it as the whole enchilada. In a few weeks or months, when the protective grace is removed that was needed for that moment of deep healing, they often are faced with anger and disappointment at God because He didn't live up to their faith claim for Him. Some use that as an excuse to return to the gay lifestyle. So we need to be careful in these situations. Affirm what God is doing, rather than dampening their faith by denying their claim outright. Be careful not to encourage, however, such grandiose claims unless the Holy Spirit is bearing a clear and unmistakable witness to your spirit that it is true, or until you've seen several years of fruit consistent with the claim. If God were to zap most gays straight, they would still be left with unformed identities, strong compulsions to idolatry, arrested emotional development, sexual perversion, soul ties, demonic strongholds, unforgiveness, roots of anger, etc., etc., etc. Instead, He uses the opportunity of the multifaceted nature of our brokenness to bring us into the healing of a multiplicity of related issues. He kills 50 birds with one stone, in a sense. And He also produces character, a love of holiness, a love of God, and many other spiritual qualities in the process. Pretty smart, I think. What are some of the pitfalls to avoid? Well, a big mistake that church folk often make is communicating expectations for healing that are unreasonable considering the number of issues that are involved. It is right to expect a decision to forsake sexually immoral behavior once the person has made a decision to make Jesus the Lord of his life. However, if we put too much pressure on them to be rid of their effeminacy, for example, before they have gained the capacity to do so, we can actually send them running back into the lifestyle. Men's groups are often at fault here. In order to help the guy heal, they sometimes throw him into all kinds of manly behaviors, rafting, sports, hunting, when these may have been the very activities that surrounded the rejection that he received while growing up. In essence, the well-meaning macho men are forcing him to fail once again and to re-experience the humiliation that has haunted him his entire life. Macho men's groups that make no place for the more sensitive or more damaged male can be dangerous places for a healing person. They often project an ideal of what it means to be a man that is in itself seriously broken and perverted, a version of masculinity that Jesus himself would find abhorrent. In short, some of these ever-straight guys need to get some healing of their own before a person coming out of homosexuality will ever want to be like them. Another common problem is the well-meaning ladies who constantly ask the former homosexual, "Got a girl yet?" Please, I can't tell you how damaging statements like that can be to those who have been pressured so heavily by females in the past that comments like that only deepen their fear of ever finding healing. If you push a healing homosexual into marriage too soon, it can permanently set his or her healing back.
Pure passion that beats for Christ alone.
In addition to hosting the Pure Passion Show, I've been doing a radio program called The Blazing Grace Show for the past 4 years. We cover everything related to sexual brokenness and recovery, including lust, pornography, adultery, codependency, and related topics such as sexual slavery, prostitution, and even how God redeems all these tragedies. Find all our free archived podcasts at healingforthesoul.org/radio show.
As you may have guessed, due to time limitations, we can only include a small portion of David Kyle Foster's teaching on homosexuality in these two Pure Passion TV programs. If you want to know more about how homosexuality develops and how God brings healing, you can obtain David's complete teaching on DVD from our online store. Just look for the DVD entitled Homosexual Confusion, Understood and Healed. Available now at www.purepassion.us. That's www.purepassion.us.
What are the distinctives in ministering to gays versus lesbians? Surveys vary, but between 65 and 85% of all lesbians are victims of childhood sexual abuse. The figure for male homosexuals hovers around 50%. And so lesbians are more likely to have fear, anger, or even hatred issues with the opposite sex. Many lesbians will tell you that they chose to be lesbian. Few male homosexuals would ever say such a thing. The attraction of the lesbian toward other women, more often than not, has to do with a flight into their safe, comforting embrace in reaction to the experiences that they've had with abusive men. Lesbianism is an emotional flight, and since it is often in reaction to the kind of abuse where their identity has been suppressed or destroyed, there is often an emotional enmeshment or a blending of identities between the two partners. One partner subsumes her identity into that of the other. So the healing process in such a case will involve dealing with issues such as unforgiveness, damaged sense of being, idolatry, hatred, lust, and anger. To a lesser degree, there are some lesbians who have developed their neurosis because they never emotionally bonded with their mothers, in the same way that many men never bonded with their fathers. The healing process in those cases will be similar to that of the men. So women in ministry, be aware of the lesbian who is trying to attach her identity to yours. If that begins to happen, sever the relationship and bring in someone else. Men in ministry to lesbians, it will be rare that you will be able to do much in the way of ministry, as you represent the object of hurt and anger to so many. The less you remind them of their abuser, the softer and gentler you are, the more you may be able to minister to them. Be sensitive to the need of many lesbians, however, to have a woman help them, and don't take it personally. God, as a male figure, is often a big hurdle for lesbians. It is often good to point out that when God made mankind in His image, both the male and the female were declared to be representative of Him. So although we use male pronouns to describe God, everything that is good in the feminine is a part of Him as well. Emphasize Jesus rather than God the Father in the early stages of the healing process, because He's more approachable for many lesbians. If their confusion arose as a result of not bonding with their mother, help them to understand that the feminine that they have been searching for, as well as its affirmation in them, is found in God and can be procured from Him. Again, He possesses all that is good of the feminine as well as all that is good of the masculine. Forgiveness will often be the hardest part of a lesbian's healing process. Do not make the mistake of demanding it from them before God has made them ready for it. If you do, it can send them fleeing from God altogether. When the day is right for them to forgive, it will be an empowerment and impartation from God Himself that enables them to do so. One of the most important things you can do for a healing homosexual is to show them how to be intimate with the Father and to receive emotional bonding and healing from Him. Reconciliation with their earthly father can be important when possible, but it is not necessary for the healing to take place. They can get it from God the Father Himself. A second very important thing is that they learn how to let God do it for them. Too many people try to go after their healing under their own strength, wisdom, and power, and they always fail when they do that. It's a big trap, so teach them how to let God do it for them. They need to have hope and a vision for a transformed future. They need to know what true love really is and to receive it from you and from other Christians. They need to be accepted on an equal basis by their same-sex peer group. They need to find their true identity in Christ. They need to be healed from their fear or hatred of the opposite sex and receive a right view of that gender. They need to be freed from their idolatry of the same sex. And they need to have their inner rebellion quenched by a right view of God. They need to learn to trust God, His Word, to love what He loves, and to hate what he hates. In short, the healing of the homosexual, at a minimum, requires salvation, renewing the mind through Scripture, aggressive spiritual warfare, worship, inner healing ministry, freedom mediated through the body, service and ministry to others, and learning to weather the wilderness periods of life.
Pure passion that beats for Christ alone.
As you may have guessed, due to time limitations, we can only include a small portion of David Kyle Foster's teaching on homosexuality in these two Pure Passion TV programs. If you want to know more about how homosexuality develops and how God brings healing, you can obtain David's complete teaching on DVD from our online store. Just look for the DVD entitled Homosexual Confusion, Understood and Healed. Available now at www.purepassion.us. That's www.purepassion.us.
Are you gay? If so, I want you to know that God loves you and has no desire to condemn you. He wants to set you free, just like He has me, Jason, and countless others. I know you've been told that you can't be healed from homosexuality, but that's simply not true. Tens of thousands, possibly millions of people could tell you otherwise. It's like Mark Twain's complaint when they thought he was dead. He famously wrote, "The report of my death is an exaggeration." Well, the claim that homosexuals cannot change is also an exaggeration at best, and in so many cases, willful deception that turns a blind eye to the masses of people who have indeed been healed. Even the American Psychiatric Association's benighted psychiatrist, Dr. Robert Spitzer of Columbia University, who was at the forefront of proclaiming that homosexuals could not change, finally decided to actually do a proper study of the evidence and found that indeed they could. Well, he is no longer benighted in the APA because he dared to tell the truth about an issue that has been driven by politics rather than facts. It wouldn't make any sense for God to command us to express ourselves only in heterosexual marriage relationships if He did not also provide a way to heal those who, through no fault of their own, grew up with homosexual confusion. God has made a way of escape for that sinful orientation, just as He has for every other sinful orientation. Even better, He has made a way of escape from the orientation to sin altogether by providing an orientation not to sin for those who will give their lives into His hands and who will allow Him to transform them into a new creation. He's made this provision by dying on the cross to pay the penalty for the sins of anyone who would deny themselves and follow Him. And He has provided healing for our fallen condition and atonement for those times when we still fail to keep His commandments. He has done it all. So fall in love with this Jesus. He hasn't come to condemn you. He has come to set you free. Until next week, I'm David Kyle Foster for Pure Passion.